A very good morning to all. Welcome back to the fourth day of faculty development program on applications of 3D printing technology in engineering education, sponsored by AICTE Training and Learning Academy, organized by Department of Mechanical Engineering, Dayanand Sir College of Engineering. It's my immense pleasure to welcome you all back for the fourth day's first session. So in the yesterday session, we have seen many exciting sessions which were based upon metal 3D printing, medical applications and marine applications. So today we are going to start first session with Mr. Maltesh Yes, who is the founder and CEO of Supercraft 3D. I heartily welcome you for the faculty development program on behalf of Department of Mechanical Engineering, DSE, sir. Before I start with today's session, I would like to just give a brief introduction about Mr. Maltesh. He is the CEO and founder of Supercraft 3D, which is an additive manufacturing service bureau which focuses on healthcare and medical applications. Mr. Maltesh completed his MSc, Master of Science in Law and Accounting from London School of Economics and Political Science, and his bachelor's was in BCom, Bachelor of Commerce in Tax Law or Taxation from Kurempo University, where he secured first rank and he pursued it in 1996. In his postgraduate work experience with Dresdner Kallenwerth in London, where he was involved in equity research analyst with focus on gaming and healthcare industry. Previously, Mr. Maltesh worked as head of business strategy for the Wipro Infrastructure Engineering with specific focus on new initiatives and adoption of additive manufacturing. Sir was also involved with startup of knowledge process offshoring at Wipro and before that at Infosys. Sir, it's our immense pleasure that we have with us today, and I once again heartily welcome you. Over to you, sir.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Good morning, everybody. I'll just start by sharing my screen. Right. All right. Good morning. And I'm assuming that everybody can hear me. So
it's clear.
Yeah. Thank you so much for that warm introduction. And thank you for giving me this opportunity to be able to present about what we do at Supercraft 3D. Supercraft 3D came about as a rejection from when I was working at Wipro. So I was working in Wipro and I started Wipro 3D division in 2011 as head of strategy. And while we were focused on space and aerospace applications, I realized that we could also do medical implants and other medical related products using 3D printing. But there was hesitancy to move into medical field within Wipro for various reasons, absolutely genuine reasons. And that's when I thought that I should come out and start this company. So at that point in time, there was a gentleman called Avid Reichenthal, who used to be the CEO of 3D Systems, which is the largest 3D printing company in the world, in terms of machine manufacturing and as well as some of the services that it offers. So the CEO of that company was retiring, and that's when both of us got in touch with each other and we decided to start this company called Supercraft 3D. So it's been a little over 5 years since we started this company. In 2016, we started this company. And our initial reaction was that we should focus our energies on research and development in developing and designing the right products for 3D printer, for the general market, using 3D printing as a means of manufacturing. So we established ourselves in Singapore, primarily because the academia in Singapore is very supportive. There's a lot of funding available for academia for us to do projects together. We're also able to do a lot of research work together. And a lot of activities, which I'll come to in later on during the presentation, helped us to get to the market in a more stable manner. So keeping that in mind, you know, I'll start about what is it that we do. And, you know, I mean, I'm okay with anybody asking me questions in between, but if the host wants to keep the questions to the end, that's also fine with me. So I'll start off by telling you what is it that we do. So we are a company, a 3D printing company that's focused only on medical applications. When I say medical, it is both for intra-op as well as for companies that are manufacturing medical devices that require a more sterile manufacturing facility or FDA-approved facility, so that you know, certain components need to be manufactured, which it is similar to, you know, aerospace FAA approval. So those sort of companies, we help them out. So in this context, probably we are the only company in this country which is focused only on medical applications using 3D printing. There are, of course, dozens of 3D printing service bureaus in this country, but most of them cater to almost every sector, not just medical, but they also cater to aerospace, automotive, rapid prototyping for other various applications, including white goods and all of that. But as a facility, we are focused only on designs for medical applications. So we have divided our own vision into four areas that we would like to cater to. One is the medtech, so medical technology, where we manufacture surgical instruments, either that is used for single usage or patient specific. We also work with various medical device companies like GE, Siemens, Philips, where some of the more complex components are now being, which were traditionally manufactured and which used to take several months of design and prototyping time, are now being used. They're using 3D printers from our facility to manufacture them. The other area that we work for is for doctors. That is, you know, every doctor faces a lot of challenges when he is doing the surgery, primarily because surgical instruments, which are standard, is very difficult to apply for every patient. So sometimes the doctor requires a different surgical tool that is more patient specific. So we help them. We also help them in planning the surgery by doing 3D printed surgical models. Those models are exact replica of the anatomy of the patient on whom the surgery will be performed. So this allows the doctors to do a pre-op surgery outside of the OT table, understand the challenges of doing it, and then be able to do the in the real-time surgical room and be aware of the surprises that they may get. And third area that we work is we work with patients. When I say we work with patients, we don't necessarily directly engage with patients, but there are areas where we directly engage with patients, which is when we have to do prosthetics for them, when we have to do any cosmetic improvement on their anatomy. So in those cases, we work directly with patients, but in most cases where the patient is having has given up hope on traditional methods of of surgical instruments or surgical implants, they come to us and then they explain their challenges and we work with specialist doctors to recreate their anatomy for them. And of course, last but not the least is we also build IP, you know, intellectual property. I'll talk about the various intellectual property that we have developed and we continue to develop over the years. And because we believe that 3D printing allows us there's a lot of unexplored area in 3D printing that allows us to do this. So one of the areas that, you know, I'll talk about, and, you know, before I get to the core medical applications of implants and surgical instruments and all that, I'll also tell you about, which I mentioned earlier, is re-engineering of existing medical equipment that device manufacturers have. So if you look at, the conventional manufacturing, which is using injection molding, thermoforming, die casting, and I don't need to tell the dignitaries who are participating in this that there are a dozen other ways of manufacturing various types of products, but most of them are designed for mass manufacturing. Now, medical device industry, like aerospace industry, is not a mass manufacturing sector, except for few products like injections, vials, and, you know, the day-to-day consumption items. Most medical devices in the country get manufactured in 1,000 to 2,000 units every year. Now, if you look at even more expensive items like an MRI machine, which typically costs between $1 million to $1.5 million, a CT machine, which costs roughly about 1 to 2 crores, depending on the kind of slice thickness that you require. These are manufactured in few hundreds in a year. Going for conventional manufacturing for some of the more complex components in that is expensive. Tooling is expensive. And which also means that your design is locked for a significant amount of time because you have invested so much in particular tooling that you would not like to change the design of your product for a significant amount of time. Even though electronic advances are happening much faster, software advances are happening much faster, your ability to change the core hardware of the equipment is limited because of the cost. That's where we worked with GE Healthcare, Siemens, you know, Philips, and a host of other companies. We went back to them and we told them, look, if aerospace can adopt 3D printing, so can medical industry. So we started working with them and we identified certain components which we felt were suitable for application of additive manufacturing. We decided to work with it. Some of these components were so complex that typically FDA approves these components because any medical device which before it goes to the market has to be FDA approved. Now, if FDA has to approve, if any change in some of these core components has to go back for FDA certification. So we had to re-engineer some of these parts and we did it. Here's an example of one of those parts. So this is a aux bracket. It's an auxiliary bracket, which is part of the CT machine. Earlier, it used to be about 51 parts, weighing 27 kilograms, roughly about $260, about 2 hours of assembly time. And the size was half a meter by half a meter kind of a product. And of course, a built-in factor of safety is 8+. We were asked to redesign this so that we could bring a 3D printing into this. One of the reasons why this particular part was asked for us to redesign is that this is the part which carries all the various laser mounts, which is what is used to focus on the patient's anatomy. If you don't focus, this part is not accurate. You'll not get a very clear image of the patient. So therefore, when we were asked to do this, we were met with one significant challenge. This was a half a meter by half a meter product, whereas our most 3D printers are 250 mm by 250 mm, which is 1/4 the size of it in terms of surface area. And therefore, we had to go back to the drawing board and understand what exactly this part does and redesign it. Now, limitations always bring out, you know, intellectual capability in most people. When you have limited resources, you try to figure out how best to redesign something. And that's exactly what happened over here. Over a period of 6 months, working with GE Healthcare as well as our own internal team, we reduced 51 parts to 5 parts. 27 kgs became 1.8 kgs. We slashed a third of the cost. And assembly time because of this, because there was a lot of integrated manufacturing in this, came down to 15 minutes. And all of it was able to fit in our 250 by 250 metal 3D printing. And you know, while we say the factor of safety is 8+, the factor of safety in this particular case was tested to 40+. So this shows that, you know, metal 3D printing or any additive manufacturing for that matter. In fact, after this, we also went on to do a lot of polymer-based products, which were used to use a lot of, and most of them used to come from China. We started manufacturing here. I'll come back, like for instance, this particular case that you see, there's a donut in which the patient passes through. In every CT machine or an MRI machine, there's a donut. So that particular donut has to be have a single piece, because if you have a certain amount of cuts and variations in that, you will see those marks, phantom marks on the CT image or the MRI image. So we decided how could we 3D print without putting any phantom marks. And we don't have a printer that is of that size. I'll come back to that later on in terms of how we were able to manufacture that kind of a product. So this is one product which has got FDA approved. Now, pretty much every single CT machine and MRI machines that are manufactured by GE Healthcare worldwide uses this component. So what's the reasons of these things is that it allows us to do a lot of high level assemblies. A lot of multiple parts can be integrated together, which involves a lot of cost savings. It involves a lot of assembly line time. You can use polymer and metal, a combination of both of them in a single component. You can also, you know, manage inventories just in time. In the case of earlier, minimum order quantity for, you know, the part on the left was 500 units. Now, considering that an average number of product sales for GE's highest number of MRI machine sales in a year was 280 machines. Now, imagine MOQ of 500 means you have almost 2 years worth of inventory in your stock. And that's a huge amount of capital that's locked in, which also means that you cannot change the product design till such time these components are used up. With 3D printing, we were able to give it as a just-in-time. Most of the cases, we just needed 1 week's advance notice. We would manufacture, do all the post-processing that's required and deliver it on time. And they didn't need, there was no minimum order quantity. If it was one that was required for this week, it would be one. If it was four next week, it would be four. And any design changes in each of these parts, it was involved zero cost in terms of tooling. There's a cost involved for going back to FDA and getting approvals. But in terms of tooling and manufacturing, there was any incremental cost was almost zero. Now, because the part was so complex, we could also integrate a lot of functional aspects of it, including heat management, that's thermal management, EMI interference, and ensuring that it is lightweight. Most people think that lightweight is an issue only in aerospace. On the contrary, a significant portion of this CT MRI machines is because of the transportation cost. They are manufactured in two or three locations worldwide for GE. Transferring them to different parts of the world is a significant cost for them. Making them lightweight, making them as broken down kits, brings down the cost significantly. So that's another area of that we could get into it. And of course, I think my fellow speakers in the previous days must have talked about the green technology, less energy and all that. So I'm not going to repeat those points. The other area that we were interested was to become the supplier tail, you know, aggregator. What I mean by supplier tail aggregator is that in any manufacturing unit, 80% of the cost goes for 20% of the components. The costliest components take up 80% of the budget. Then 80% of the components take 20% of the budget. Now, the challenge is the 80% of the components, which are the smaller components, they may not be critical, but they are necessary. Without them, the machine or any product will not work. But it also means a lot of paperwork, a lot of vendor management, a lot of logistics management. And a single failure can hold back a lot of these activities. What we decided to work with these medical device companies was we told them to give us a list of all your supplier tail, which are the 20% budget that you have put across. Let me find out what all I can 3D print for you. And we made a list of these projects, and we decided when we aggregated all the smaller companies which they were acquiring from 60, 70 other different vendors, we became the single vendor that was capable of printing everything that all the 60, 70 vendors were earlier supplying to them. So by becoming the single vendor for all the 60 different components, we became the largest supplier for GE Healthcare. So this is the advantage of 3D printing, because you don't have a limitation on what you can actually do with your 3D printer. Okay, let me rephrase that. There are limitations, but you know, there's also a lot of freedom in what you can do with your 3D printer. So that's one of the ways of using this metal 3D printing or polymer 3D printing to bring it to your advantage that you become the single largest supplier for any of these companies. So we worked with, of course, the global MNC is healthcare over here, GE Healthcare over here. We worked in devising device HLAs, identifying the software equipment and the different beta materials that were tested with them. Currently, we are reworking on some of their ultrasound equipment. We are working on CT and PET CT equipment. And there's a list of at least other half a dozen machines that we are working, but I'm not going to list them all out over here. But you can look at some of the individual components over here that I've mentioned. The breast scan membranes. Currently, they're being imported from China and Europe. You can actually 3D print them over here. Endocavity needle for biopsy, right? Disposable, reusable, both of them we can actually 3D print. You can have ultrasound probe racks. Now, probe racks, you know, they come in standard sizes, but they're not suitable for Indian anatomy. Now, the probe racks can be customized for the particular location. And when I say that, look at the anatomical differences between within India itself, for that matter. Look at the way the Punjabis are built versus how the Northeast are built versus how the South, even within the South, if you look at how the Tamilians are versus Kannadigas are or Mallus are, everybody has huge anatomical differences. But if you have a standard ultrasound probe racks, you know, it brings in different results for different people. So we were able to customize a significant number of this with very few costs. Child positioning kits, which is an extraordinarily important thing in a CT, PET CT or a MRI machine, because, you know, there's a claustrophobia for children to be able to be left, you know, alone inside a room, you know, going through a donut that makes so much amount of noise. Children find it very fearsome, you know, it's very scary for them. So that's where, you know, we come in and we create positioning kits for children, where children can actually be sitting in a position where they don't have to get scared. You know, we included in one particular case an imaging device where the children can see their parents standing outside without having to worry that there's, you know, they've been abandoned. Laser alignment systems, which I already mentioned. Phantom shields. Now, these shields are basically to ensure that the CT, the radiation from CT affects only one part of your body, or the necessary part of the body is exposed to the radiation, not the entire human body. Not many may know this, or people may know this after the COVID started. Every time you go inside a CT machine and come out, there's a 2% chance that you have triggered cancer in your body. Okay, and there's enough and more studies to show this. Okay. So CT is not a very human-friendly machine. Many people wonder why they got cancer later on. But you know, the triggering point is sometime in their life, and very recently in their life, they will have gone through CT applications. So phantom shields was something that we were able to work with them on that. Now I'll move to the core medical side of what we do, right? So the same challenges, conventional manufacturing, you know, you have your surgical instruments that are being manufactured in the conventional way. Now, if you look at this instrument, Germany is one of the largest manufacturers of medical instruments for across the anatomy, whether it is spinal, cranial, orthopedic, any of these instruments, the best instruments come from Germany. The cheapest instruments come from Pakistan. And, you know, at least 80-85% of the instruments used in India, surgical instruments used in India, come from Rawalpindi in Pakistan. So Pakistan has been historically one of the largest manufacturers of medical instruments. Of course, the quality between the German instrument versus the ones manufactured by our neighbor is significantly different. For instance, if you were to use a bone saw that was manufactured in Germany, you can use it for at least 24 patients before the bone saw becomes a little dull for it to be used again. Whereas the ones manufactured both in India, Pakistan, or anywhere else, the typical bone saw life is between 5 to 6 patients. Of course, the costing also is significantly different. Now, majority of these instruments manufactured have been designed for doctors who are Caucasian, that is US doctors, American doctors. Their arms are much bigger, their fingers are much longer, their hands are much longer. Their height is much taller than us. Most of the average height is different. So these instruments have been designed keeping in mind average height of a Caucasian between 5'9 to 5'10. Whereas in India, the average height of an Indian male is between 5'5 to 5'6, which considerably changes the way the instrumentation can be used in a patient. And the design of the instrument is for the Caucasian anatomy. It's not designed for Indian anatomy. So doctors actually compromise a lot with Indian patients during surgery. And I'll come to a little bit more about that in the next couple of slides. But keeping that in mind, every time when we started this company, a lot of the requests came from doctors. They said, can you make surgical instruments using your 3D printing? I said, what's wrong with your current surgical instruments? They pointed out a lot of it, and we could observe it during many surgeries as well. So we decided that we will start manufacturing a few of the surgical instruments, which are critical for most doctors. And we also started getting involved in customized surgical instruments. So the image A that you see in the middle shows one of the surgical instruments that was used to trap the arteries and keep it tight so that there's no blood leak. Now, because of the cancer inside the patient's body, your standard instrument would not be able to bend and go in that fashion and be able to tighten it. Loss of blood was critical, and it was going to turn critical in this patient. So we had to prevent significant risks by ensuring that there's not too much of loss of blood. So this instrument was designed and we manufactured. You can see the fineness of the print. You can see the size of it in terms of, if you look at size, image B, you also see the comparatively, there's a matchstick that's been laid next to it. And image C shows the complexity of various things. This is an assembly of both conventionally manufactured and 3D printed parts. This took us about 48 hours to design this and give it to the doctor. Conventional manufacturing would not have allowed us to do this. In terms of surgical models that we manufacture for doctors, so typically we take X-ray images, CT images, MRI images. We convert, one of the challenges, and I'm sure I speak for pretty much everybody in the audience as well, is that when an X-ray is given to us or a CT is given to us or a MRI is given to us, we have no clue what to look for it in there. Everything is black and white. And we are unable to decipher between which is flesh, which is bone, which are nerves, which are arteries, which are veins. Where is the tumor? Where is the damage? In fact, until someone points out a hairline fracture in a bone, we are also not able to locate it. And believe it or not, except for good radiologists, most of the other surgeons also find the same challenges because they are not used to day and day, look at these kind of products. I mean, the defects. So a radiologist typically gives, and we have seen this as well, a report of what he has observed. So the X-ray report comes out, CT report comes out. They say, while the CT has been prepared, we say we have to wait for the report. And that's because it requires a professional's view of what is visible and what is not visible. Now, after paying $25,000 for an MRI, if I'm not able to figure out what it is, then you wonder what you're paying that amount for. Right? Unfortunately, the current medical device, imaging devices, come out with that. 3D printing allows us to convert these, two-dimensional images into three-dimensional images, and being able to reprint exact anatomical model of what the patient actually is. This allows us, both the patient as well as the surgeon to study the anatomy in a much better way and be able to plan what needs to be done and what doesn't need to be done. Believe me, we've done this. Providing surgical models has changed the way surgery is done. Many times what happens, most surgeries, there's a conventional way of doing it. If you have to remove a tumor inside the mouth, you have to go through the mouth or the back of the neck, various aspects of it. And there are certain standard operating procedures. But when you give them a certain model, things change. We had a case recently, this was between the first COVID wave lockdown and the second COVID wave lockdown. We had a case where a patient had a tumor at the bottom of his brain. And the doctors were wondering how to remove that because removing a significant portion and reaching the bottom of the brain is not so easy. We 3D printed the anatomy and gave it to the doctor. And we also did the study of the nasal cavity. We realized that through the nasal cavity, the doctor could actually reach to the bottom of the tumor scrape it out. The tumor was hardly 3 mm in size. And they were able to scrape it out, bring it out, and without doing a single cut on the skull of the patient. The patient was admitted in the morning, put under general anesthesia. The surgery was done in a matter of 40, 45 minutes. I was there as part of the surgery. The patient was wheeled back to observation room. He didn't even go into the ICU, by the way. And the next day he was discharged. Had it not been for the surgical model, the doctor would have done what he would typically do. Split open the skull, remove the brain, turn it around, scrape it out, put it back in, and wait for the patient to recover over the next 2-3 weeks. Right? So that's where surgical models help a lot. The other aspect of it is, you know, when doing this kind of surgeries, we also had to give the doctor a lot of, supportive instruments. While theoretically, you know, we may show that there is a nasal cavity through which you can reach, there are no standard instruments available for that. So that's where we step in and we tell them that, look, there are certain instruments that we can actually manufacture for you. And they will be manufactured using materials which are biocompatible, and, you'll be able to use it. So giving a model and surgical instruments, the doctor is able to actually check it out if it works. On the model, he will make his first attempt, maybe multiple attempts to try and figure out what could go wrong. If he feels comfortable that everything is going to go right, he will actually do it in the surgery table as well. The other aspect of it is many of these surgical instruments, now what we are working on, and these days, startup means you have to have some software involved as well. So we are also working on a software which can automatically assess what kind of an instrument is required. So if we find out where the tumor is, and once we point it out into the software, we are trying to bring in artificial intelligence, machine learning, the nice glorified words of various aspects. We're trying to bring in the kind of automation to try and see what is the best way to do the surgery. Here's an example of how we actually achieve that. Here's a patient who has a tumor. Now that tumor has been identified, this is a facial recognition software which identifies and superimposes the X-ray CT image onto the patient's anatomy. Once that is done, we also identify where exactly inside are the various defects inside the thing. Now, once you cut the jaw, you need to ensure that the reconstruction of the jaw has to be done in such a way that the aesthetics, the look and feel of the patient remains the same. The cosmetic is very important because every single person has a different jaw structure. Every single person, uniqueness comes because of their jaw. So therefore, reconstruction of that is very important. The software tells us where we need to cut, how much we need to cut. Once that has been done, it also tells us, so most of the jaw reconstructions are done by using fibula, especially in cancer cases. So fibula is the additional bone at the next to tibia. Tibia is the lower half of your, from femur to your ankle is the tibia. That's the load-bearing one. There's a supportive bone called fibula, which is attached to tibia. It used to be very helpful when we were all apes, and we used to use our leg as frequently as our hands to grip the branches and climb and all that. But unfortunately, we lost that skill. We didn't gain any other skill. And there's an extra bone that's lying waste. So the doctors typically use this bone to recreate the jaw. Now, when you're going to harvest this bone, recreate, you need to bring in the same shape as what it used to be before. So that's where the cuts, as well as the depth of cuts, are designed by the software, and it helps us to recreate it. The second way of doing it is also to 3D print the entire implant itself, the bone itself. So here's the case of a 27-year-old female. It shows the CT image, shows the mandible cancer in the lower left part of her jaw. We decide where it needs to be cut. So those are 3D printed cutting guides which fit exactly onto her teeth, and the angle of cut is predetermined. The doctor has to just snap these onto those the particular teeth which we have mentioned. Once they have snap fit, they have passed the bone cutter through that, and a bone saw through that, and you get a nice clean straight cuts. Now we know the exact amount of cut. We have already through software, we know exactly where the cuts will be and the implant will be made. Once that implant is made, the doctor has to just snap fit this, put the four screws, close the incision that he has made, and the patient wakes up with teeth in our mouth. In this particular case, you can see the implant also has the dental stubs, the implant stubs. All that the doctor needs to do on top of this is put crowns, and the patient will be able to start using her mouth again. Typically, most of these jaw reconstruction surgeries used to take between 8 to 15 hours, depending on the complexity of the case. Shortest would be 8 hours. With using 3D printed cutting guides and implants, surgery has come down to less than an hour now. That's the amount of time saving that you have. In India, jaw cancer or oral cancer is the largest cancer. 20% of male cancer is oral cancer, followed by your lung and prostate and all of those. In female, the second largest cancer is oral cancer. The first is breast cancer, followed by oral, then uterus and various others. It shows the number of people who are eating gutkha, pan, all tobacco-related products are getting affected by this. And there's a significant demand for jaw reconstructions. And that's where we step in and do that. And of course, recently, because of COVID and the unfortunate black fungus, a lot of people have seen the need for reconstruction of their maxilla as well as mandible part of their anatomy. Another area that we are working, which is also highly automated, is skull reconstruction. Now, cranial reconstruction happens for two reasons. One is either because we have a lot of youngsters who fall off their bikes, who do wheelies on highways, you know, and meet with accidents, who don't wear helmets. So we have a significant number of youngsters who come and have their broken skulls repaired by us. It also happens in elderly patients where they have strokes. When a person has a stroke, you know, the immediate thing what a surgeon does is to remove a portion of the skull to relieve the pressure which is inside the brain. Now, once this has been done, it is the portion of the skull, the cranial flap which has been removed, is kept in a bone freezer for as long as it is required for the patient to come back to normalcy. Typically, it takes anywhere between a month and a half for, you know, a person with stroke to come to some sense of some level of normalcy. After that, if the patient is back to normal, then what the doctors do is they replace the cranial flap. In olden days, what they would do is they would keep the In very early days, what they would do is they would remove the flap and keep it in the tummy because that's a nice sterile area. They would cut open the tummy, keep it there and stitch it up back again. Wait for the patient to get back to normalcy. Then again, open up the tummy and take out the bone flap, refix it. Now, there's a limitation to that because if we don't do it within a month, month and a half, the bone that's kept inside the body, or for that matter, in the bone refrigerator, bone freezer, they tend to shrink. And the second aspect of it is that it also tends to rot. It starts to decay, which can cause some amount of infection if you use the same product. Till 3D printing came about, majority of the times what the doctors would do is they would take a sheet metal and bend it to the appropriate shape. Therefore, it depends on the artistic skill of the doctor to bend it to that shape, and then put screws, and that's where they would end it. So if doctor was not very artistic, you would obviously see dissymmetry or asymmetry in the patient's face. Using 3D printing, we are able to do this exact replica of what the entire shape of the skull was. And we were able to recreate it. Here is one of the first cases that we did almost 4 years back. Of course, now we do almost a dozen cases a week in these sort of cases. But this shows the what has happened in this thing. This surgery, which was done here in Sparsh, the patient was 37 year old. The entire surgery took less than half an hour on that day. Usually it used to take about 3 hours. It took less than half an hour because the doctor had to just open up the top of the skull, put this, screw it up, put it back, do the stitches. What you see in the bottom left is the patient after 6 weeks. You can see all his hair has grown back. You cannot even see the cut that has been done on the patient. Reason I show this image is because this sort of a skull, which is 3D printed and meets the exact shape requirements, allows for better blood flow and better integration of the skull, the implant with the skull. Conventional sheet bending activities which were done by doctor, you would see the asymmetry and also you would see certain patches of hair growth not happening because there's not enough blood supply. Here's another case. This is far more vivid. You can see the amount of damage to the left side of the skull. This is pre-op photo. We can see the amount of damage that he has had. That's the 3D printed, metal 3D printed implant. And that's what you get during surgery image, post-surgery. That surgery, that patient took his own selfie next morning and sent it to me, saying that I'm doing absolutely fine. Thank you for sending me the implant. Right? 3 days later, he was actually able to walk out of this surgery. So we do a lot of implants, not just jaw implants and cranial implants. We do implants for all trauma cases. We also do implants for all onco-ortho cases. That is orthopedic damage that has happened because of cancer. Conventional implants, and I'll show you some images later on also live. You can see conventional implants pretty much same size. Which also means that wherever there is a more defect, the extra defect is filled with bone cement or wedges, and then the implant is fixed. Bone cement has a certain amount of life cycle. After 2 years, 3 years, the bone cement becomes loose, and then the implant starts to shake, which is why you see a lot of elderly people, even after hip replacement, couple of years, 3 years down the line, they'll again be complaining of pain, or they'll not be able to walk properly. There'll be instability in their walking. That's because the bone cement has come loose. The screws which were aligned were not integrated well with the bone, because standard implants have standard screw locations. So if there is not enough bone over there, then you're going to miss out the screw. Whereas 3D printed implants, we look at the patient's anatomy, find out where all the defects are. We put the screw locations based on the bone density that we study. We also ensure that every defect is filled with the appropriate metal. And there's a different amount of porosity at different parts of the implant to ensure better osseointegration. So the advantages, we have a significant surgery time reduction, anywhere between 30%, 70%. Sometimes, doctors are very happy because when we do jaw reconstructions, especially what they would have assumed would be an 8-10 hour operation without lunch break, without any other break, they're able to finish it up in an hour, which also means for hospital, you have better OT utilization. If entire operating theater was going to be used by one surgery for the day, you're now able to use it 2-3 times, the same OT 2-3 times in a day. It also means that the patients are recovering faster. Earlier cranial surgeries, minimum 1 week to 2 weeks of hospitalization was required if you're going to replace any part of the skull. Now the patient is discharged on the second or the third day. Jaw reconstructions, patient is discharged on the third day. So the hospitals don't need to invest in a lot more beds. Their existing beds are becoming freer much earlier. 3D models, I already mentioned the extraordinary impact that 3D models have before pre-surgery. It also means that patients are exposed less. Typical infection time for the when a wound has happened, whether it is a cut during the surgery or otherwise, infection starts 90 minutes after the cut has happened. So if you can close the surgery within that 90 minutes, the chances of hospital infection are much, much lesser. If a surgery was going to take 8 hours, 9 hours, during that 8 hours, 9 hours, after the first 1.5 hours, the chances of infection happening to the patient increases as time increases. We have reduced the chances of infection significantly. So I was talking about intellectual property. What is it that we work on? I already mentioned about the various medical software that we've been working on. One is automated segmentation of CT images, MRI images. We are working with a different company to convert 2D X-ray images into 3D images based on a significant amount of data. So we take lateral view, frontal view, and you know the different views of X-rays. And from that, we are able to recreate. As of now, we have done, I think, 3 cases relying on that 3D image to go to the thing. Because as I mentioned earlier, to be able to recreate a 3D model of a patient, we either need CT image or an MRI image, and we are not very fond of, you know, patients going under CT. Whereas X-ray is okay. X-ray is also radiation, but one single X-ray exposure is less than 1/500th of a CT exposure. So the risks are significantly reduced when you go for an X-ray. So if you can create a 3D image using X-ray, now there's nothing like it. We also do a significant amount of research on new materials, both for surgical instruments as well as implants and medical devices. Well, you know, so all sorts of material research happens. And implant design. Now, implant design is, as I said, anatomical differences between Indians and Caucasians, Asians and Caucasians, Caucasians versus Africans, Caucasians versus South Americans. There's a huge amount of difference. When I say Asia, I talk about Chinese to Indians to Arabs. We all have huge anatomical differences. But using a standard knee replacement TKR implant, total knee replacement implant, or a hip replacement implant, basically we are compromising the anatomy to fit that particular implant. As an example, when knee replacement is done in India, the femur and the tibia, each side, we lose anywhere between 5 to 6 mm. So a total of 1 whole centimeter of bone is removed from our body. The same implant, if it's used on a Caucasian, you lose 1 to 1.5 mm on the femur and 1 to 1.5 mm on the tibia. So that's about 2 mm to 3 mm of the bone. So you can see the amount of bone loss that we have to undergo just to make sure that our European implants fit us. The second challenge is we are not be able to lead the conventional lifestyle that we have. Indians have different toilets, you know, usage ways. Indians like to be able to sit on the floor and eat, which after these, you know, using the standard Johnson & Johnson implants, etc., you'll not be able to do that. If you're able to design an implant that is suitable for Indians, then you're able to go back to your original lifestyle. Advantage of additive manufacturing is you're able to do a lot of porous scaffoldings inside the implant. If you look at the image on the bottom right, you can see what used to be earlier plates that used to be put again to, you know, put together two bones. You can actually create an implant with high amount of porosity, fill it with hydroxyapatite or bioglass, and within a week or two, you'll see a huge amount of bone growth happening inside it itself. Which means that you don't have to depend on too much metal to hold the body. So one of the areas that we keep working on is the kind of scaffold designs that allows us to have a lot more porosity. Ideally, an implant should have 70% porosity for bone growth. Can we go up to 80% without compromising on its load bearing? Can we go up to 85%? So every percent that you want to increase requires a huge amount of study, design validation, to be able to check whether that kind of porosity can actually have the load bearing. As we mentioned earlier, the factor of safety is important. In terms of materials, we are also working with academia in Singapore, where we are studying nanocellulose. Nanocellulose is basically the microfibrillated cellulose that you can find in most trees and plants. This is what holds leaves together, trees together. That's the carbon fiber equivalent of nature. We are able to now extract it. We are also able to convert the fibers into more powderish form. Using this powder form, we are trying to see if we can manufacture products. We are in fairly good stage of research in this particular product. The beauty of nanocellulose, you know, is that, you know, it has a huge, you know, it's high good, it's fairly good in tensile strength. It's, you know, it's got high stiffness, it's got high strain. There are some lot of, I think there is a significant amount of spelling errors in this particular slide. But anyway, I guess you get the idea. That's what you see in the cup is what has been extracted from the plants. It comes as a gel format. But it's the beauty for medical applications, it is biocompatible. You can actually make implants out of this. And the, you know, apart from titanium and cobalt chrome and some, you know, few grades of steel, there are not too many materials which are biocompatible. So this is going to be one of the nature's materials which will allow us to make implants out of this. I'm almost towards the end of my presentation. So we also work with institutes like oncology, Bangalore Institute of Oncology and HCG for all the cancer research that we do. We work with Hosmat hospitals for all the ortho-onco and orthopedic surgeries. We work with Photocentric and Nanyang Technology NTU in Singapore for new material development, testing and validation. And NUS is our partner for designs. A lot of students in NUS collaborate with us. They take active part in our in the work that we do and keep coming up with new solutions. They do all the grunt work to, you know, of data validation. So that's something that we do. We three are the founders, myself, gentleman called Sri Krishna, who used to be earlier with GE Healthcare, and Avi Rachenthal, who is the former CEO of 3D Systems, as I mentioned, and then he's now running his own different company called Exponential Works as well in the US. So I know this program is supposed to be for 90 minutes, but I'm happy to take questions from the audience to understand, you know, if they have any questions, I'm happy to answer. If I can't answer, I'll say I can't answer because I'm not the most brainy guy around here as well. So.
Thank you very much, sir. So participants, the session is open for questions. So if you have any questions, you can please post it in the chat box or else you can unmute yourself and ask the questions. You can post your questions in the chat box.
If there are no questions, I think we can wrap up the session as well.
Sir, I just think, okay, that's not a question. They say that they got information more about CT scan. Okay, right. Sir, I have one small question from my side.
Please.
Sir, whenever you print like any body parts, like let us say for aesthetic, you know, leg or hands with 3D printing, most of them will be like probably done with, I feel, lightweight materials. What about fit strength, sir? Means when you actually do it with respect to any metal parts, obviously it will be more heavy, but strength will be good. But with respect to if you go with any other parts like polymers, and if you're talking about a prosthetic leg, so what about its strength? How durable it can be?
Yeah, thank you for this question, Anand, sir. So you have multiple materials that give you a considerable amount of strength. So, you know, you have PEKK, PEEK, PEEK, PEEK materials, peak and PEC materials, which are extremely strong materials, which have high load bearing capability, and the amount of fatigue it can take is also equivalent to almost a metal kind of products. Apart from that, you can also design certain products which need not necessarily, if you take it as is, it may not be strong. But by having design changes, you can actually bring in additional strength, having additional ribs in the design, bringing in arches at appropriate places, you'll be able to add more load bearing capability. So strength can be through design, need not necessarily be through material. So these are two aspects that we work on. One is we, of course, try and choose the best polymer material, which will bring them strength. But also we bring in strength through design.
Okay, sir. So can you please once again tell that material which you said?
PEEK.
Okay.
And PEKK.
PEKK. Okay, because one of our participants, Mr. Suresh P, was asking the same question.
Okay.
So I hope they got their answers. They are like, what is the best material for 3D implants like bone or skull or knee?
Oh, for those aspects of it, titanium is better. If it is this thing. So PEEK is basically, it's called polyether ether ketone.
Okay.
Okay. It's a thermoplastic polymer. And it is, of course, used in aerospace significantly, but it's also highly biocompatible. So that's one of the things that since 1980s, it has been used in medical applications. Nowadays, you're getting spinal cages that are made of PEEK, as well as screws that are made of PEEK material. So, and it has a high melting point. So that's also another advantage of this material.
Okay, sir. We have one more question from Mr. Basavaraj. Yes. They are asking, does this 3D implants help in forensic science also?
So I believe forensics is basically to reevaluate whether a certain, and applications of forensics are significant. 3D models I've heard being used because we've had a cases where a couple of crime branch inspectors came to us and they said, can you recreate this anatomy for us to see how it was before the things? We've had lawyers come to us and ask us for recreation of certain anatomical parts. I believe that will come under forensics as well. So implants per se, I have no idea because I think we have not done any such work.
Okay, sir. Thank you. I just had one more question, sir, from my side. Basically, whenever you 3D print any structures, it will be like a layer by layer technique. So definitely there will be a problem of delamination over a period of time. So are these 3D printed implants repairable? It means if any delamination goes through that, can they be repaired once again and reused?
Okay. So the implants that we manufacture are metal implants. So the chances of delamination are next to nil.
Okay.
Because this is a melt pool and it's like, almost like laser welding. So the chances of delamination, we have not heard either in aerospace applications or medical applications where we have had delamination. Of course, when you use, polymer printing like FDM printers and all that, you have issues of delamination, but those printers are not suitable to manufacture anything which is functional in nature. They are more for a prototype and that aspect of it. Metal implants, chances of delamination are, I think even FDA has approved most of these implants, and chance of delamination are next to nil.
Okay, sir. Right, sir. One more last question I had, sir. Whenever you are, I have read it somewhere or heard somewhere that if you try to print a perfect spherical out of a 3D printer, it is like very difficult to do it. I mean, is that this offsetting problem? If I want to print a perfect spherical, is it possible or is that somewhere like offset problems still occur in 3D printing?
So I'll answer that in the manner that I know. See, what happens when you print a sphere? The bottom half of the sphere can be printed fairly easily. It's the top half of the sphere, because as the layer is being printed over and over, if you are printing it without a scaffold, the chances are it will collapse. It is like trying to create a Golgumbas dome without any structures, you know, scaffolds to hold it in place. So, yeah, you know, that's the challenging part. So if you're creating a sphere with hollow inside, then you have a challenge. If you're creating a sphere which is absolutely solid, then you will not have any problem. So the problem is not with related to offsetting. The problem is the collapse of the upper layer onto the bottom layer, because it doesn't have a scaffold structure.
So supports will be required.
Supports is required. That's why I said if you're going to print a solid material, then you should be able to get a perfect sphere. If you're going to have a hollow sphere, then the challenge is to me.
Okay, sir. Yeah, thank you very much, sir. I see that there are no more questions in the chat box, sir. I think we can wind up this session.
Thank you so much, everybody. Thanks for this session. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Yeah, thank you very much, sir. Once again, I thank you for your time and coming here and giving the presentation.
My pleasure. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. So, dear participants, you are winding up this session. So, next session will be at 12 o'clock. So, please join us at sharp 12. Thank you.